Also, das in der Tomatiliane, Talamgyuni, Sinsinangengi,
Begin today. I would like to offer my greetings to all of everyone listening over the internet, all the lamas, cholkos, and spiritual friends, and in particular to all the monks and nuns who are listening, as well as all the people all over the world, all my Dharma friends who have faith. So I'd like to offer you a warm greeting. Today is the second to last day of our teachings. I'm not sure how to say this in Tibetan. Maybe I should, there's no need to say it perhaps. It's the day before the last day. No point in saying that. So before we begin the teaching, in the past few days, for the I wrote a long life prayer for Kenshin Thangpa Rinpoche to be swiftly freed of his illness, and I've been asked to recite the give the transmission of it, so I shall give the transmission of it. If I have time, then later, I thought we should recite this a couple times, or maybe three times. The other day, our teaching was very long, and I thought it's probably give everyone difficulty in having your supper. So we should take this opportunity today, and what I thought I should take the opportunity to say today is, in Nepal, we're having the Kanjen Tungdrup Puja. And I think that's very wonderful that it has happened. Today is the second year that it has been held. So I'd like to take this opportunity to offer some praise to Chöje Lama Phuntsok for Kagyengi Puja. He's asked me to speak about the benefits of the pujas, but in the time I did not have the opportunity to make any recording. So later I will make a recording and send it to you. So today we are speaking about the 33rd of the good deeds from the autobiographical verses, Good Deeds. Now, as I mentioned the other day, there are two manuscripts of Sangye Paldrup's commentary in the meeting. There's one from the Potala and one that comes from the Jepung Library. So these two manuscripts, and there are big differences between the two. And so today, we've primarily been talking from the outline from the Jaipung manuscript. And so I've been using, now in terms of the actual meaning, I'm taking points from both the Potala and the Jaipung manuscripts, and I'm combining these two. It's not just the Jaipung manuscript. I'm combining what is in the Potala and the Jaipung manuscripts and mixing them together. I'm just combining these as I teach. Now, according to the outline from the Jaipung manuscript, at this point we are speaking about is among the three main topics are primarily the practice, we're primarily speaking about the practices of the three types of individuals. We're speaking about that's the main practice. And then, and of these three, we've already talked about the lesser and middling individuals. So now we're speaking about how we practice the third practice of the third the path of great individual, and now we're speaking about the third of the three points of that, which is how we trained in the two precepts of the two types of bodhicitta. Now that has seven subtopics. And so what we've come to today is the seventh, how the six clairvoyances gave him the ability to benefit others. Now, among the 33 good deeds in the autobiographical verses, good deeds, this is the last of the good deeds, the 33rd. And the root text reads, someone who does not have the clairvoyance of exhausting defilements cannot benefit students. So I perfected accumulation, purification, and developed a zest for benefiting beings throughout space. I think of this as one of my good deeds. In the time of the five degenerations, whether you're a Lama or Tulku or a Rinpoche or whoever you are, there's someone who says that you're benefiting other beings. And if there's some that there's someone that they're protecting sentient beings, their guardian and protector, most of these people, the way they act is that they said, well, actually what they should be doing, if you want to practice your students from the ocean of samsaric suffering, first of all, you have to teach your students the faults of samsara and the advantages of nirvana. So that they can understand to a fair degree how much the nature of samsara is suffering. Nirvana is the nature is happiness, and that this is what we should seek. So when you've brought them to understand this, then we need to understand the points about crucial points about happiness and suffering. What we want is happiness, and what we don't want is suffering. But we do not practice the causes of happiness. Instead, we do not give up the causes of suffering. And so we need to make people understand these points. Understand what we need to make people understand what they should do and what they should give up and what they should give up. So we need to give up, have this practice of taking up what they need to take up, the virtuous roots of gathering accumulations and purifying obscurations. And we must use many different methods to bring them onto the path of gathering accumulations and purifying obscurations. If you do this, then the students Well, then within the students' mind streams, the qualities of faith and so forth will ripen. And there's just some warmth that comes from that as they're gradually ripening. There are certain different points, there are particular eliminating obstacles and enhancements. Similarly, as you're going through, look at the level of the warmth, the level of experience, and when you're getting a certain amount of experience, then you need to use, teach in the profound dharma of vast means that is included within means and prajna, and you may then make them practice this. This is the way that one should ripen and liberate students. If you do this, this is the true path, the true way of bringing others to ripening liberation taught by the Buddhas and the great beings. But in a degenerate time, everyone who is given the name Lama or Trulku, and I'm given the name of a spiritual master. Do not really understand this point about how they should teach the path, how they teach the point of what one should do and what should not do. And so then, but because of past karma, there are many people who gather around them. Whether or not they're gathering because they have qualities of abandonment and realization, a lot of people who gather because of past karma, these are actually who are actually a little bit, you could say they're a little bit unruly people, or they have bad characters. They're not really that good characters. And there's so many such people gather around him. And since they're gathering so many such people, then they're guessing from based on their own knowledge in schools, they give the teachings on vows of refuge, or you teach them, make them study, or make them do meditation. You do many methods. And if they listen to what you say and do as you ask, then you continue to care for them and continue to foster them and continue to give them advice. If some of them do not listen to what you say and don't do as you want them to do, then you kind of discipline them and you act with them a little bit more forcefully or more wrathfully. In brief, you don't have any time to sleep at night, you don't have any time to relax during the day. In this way, they don't have true listening contemplative meditation, but they pretend to do listening contemplative meditation. There's like a big brouhaha, a lot of noise about this. And so everyone's pretending to do such seeming listening, contemplating, and meditation that what people look at and they say, oh, they're really doing something to benefit sentient beings. They're helping the teachings. But this is just sort of, they just do this in order so that other people will praise them and say that other people don't do this. So the people say, this is the real, they do it so that people will be praised and that other people will be criticized. And people wait, they're hoping that. So they're keeping this thought in the heart. And so for Mikyo Dorje himself looked at such people, he can say he didn't really have much interest in them. He did not think the way they acted was good. Not only did he not think that they were acting well, he also looked at them with disgust, like, wow.
Shendun chedande, shendun yingyu da parshane.
It's unnecessary to say that such benefiting others is not truly benefiting others. He understood that this benefiting others has the great danger of being intentions and actions that would destroy everyone's lasting happiness. And so this is the way he thought about it. For Mikyo Dorje himself, he was like completely enthralled by the way the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas actually truly benefited beings. And he thought that I really need to bring benefit to sentient beings the same way that Buddhas and Bodhisattvas had. He had this very strong feeling. And so for himself, he thought he needed to emulate the activity of the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas in order to bring benefit sentient beings. And he thought, could I possibly do something to benefit beings the same way as the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas? And so this is a sort of the way he saw things, the way he acted things. And in particular, in order to be able to, if you think that you really need to be able to do something to benefit other sentient beings, the most important condition you have need is that you need to accomplish clairvoyant powers. It's, for example, it says in the 8,000 verse Prajnaparamita Sutra. It's the 18,000 verse Prajnaparamita, in which it says, Subhuti, it is thus, a bird cannot fly without wings. Subhuti, likewise, a bodhisattva cannot teach dharma without clairvoyances. Subhuti, therefore, bodhisattvas should practice transcendent prajna to accomplish the clairvoyances. With those clairvoyances, they will easily accomplish the benefits they wish to bring sentient beings. Well, this is what that says, right? So in this way, it also says in the Prajnaparamita Sutras that in order to benefit sentient beings, bodhisattvas need to accomplish clairvoyance. Without clairvoyance, you will not know how to teach the Dharma that is appropriate for sentient beings' faculties and for their interests. If you have clairvoyance, you'll be able to easily fulfill their wishes. It'll be easy for you to teach the Dharma. And the same point is also emphasized in the lamp for the path of enlightenment. These are the words, as it says, just as a bird whose wings aren't fledged cannot fly in the sky. Without the powers of clairvoyance, one cannot benefit beings. Like before, a bird to fly in the sky, you need two wings to fly. And if it doesn't have both wings, or if there is an injury to one of the wings, then it cannot fly. Likewise, if you're going to benefit other sentient beings, if you're going to teach the Dharma in a way that is appropriate for people's capacities, for their faculties, and for their interests, then you need to have the clairvoyance. You need to have the clairvoyance of knowing others' minds, telepathy. There was one time when Atisha said, what he said to Drumtumpa. So Drumtumpa was like, was Atisha's like main student. He was the important student, right? So what he said to him, so he normally called Drumtumpa Upasaka. Upasaka means someone who holds the lay precepts. Because Drumtumpa was an Upasaka who held the lay precepts. He said, Upasakas in those days mainly had long hair. So one time, Then one of the monosophists, Sera Jepung. There was a foreigner who came, and there was a Kunyun who was rather older, and they gave him an injunction to all of the statues and say, this is this person, this is that one, this is that, this being. When they got to Dzongchenpa, and he pointed this and said, this is Dzongchenpa. And the foreigner asked, is he a boy or a girl? Yeah, because he had long hair. And so he said, it's a girl. She's a girl. Because the shrine keeper didn't really understand. He must have thought, he also thought that he was extra, because he had long hair. So sometimes when people have long hair, you can't tell whether they're male or female. In any case, a teacher said that Dzongchenpa was called Upasaka. Upasaka, a teacher called him Upasaka. Upasaka. Until you have cleverness, you shouldn't nurture a group. And a group here means like you shouldn't have any students or gather monks and so forth. It's like an archer with no eyes. If someone with no eyes shoots an arrow, it's really dangerous. And the reason is because I have no idea where they're going to shoot, what it's going to hit. It's similar like that. It's same. We have the same thing of shooting an arrow in the dark when there's no light, not a lot of light, and within dark, if you shoot at an arrow in any direction, you have no idea who it's going to hit. Maybe it'll hit your friend. Maybe it'll hit your friends or your relatives. Same way, if you don't have clairvoyance, you shouldn't gather any students. It's kind of like an archer shooting an arrow. You have no idea who you're going to hit. So there's this account. And so for this reason, Mikidoje for himself, Mikidoje himself would first perceive directly the student's capacities, faculties, and latencies. And once he understood that, talked about that student's faculties and latencies meaning like the capacities and interests are difficult. It's hard for someone else to them. Sometimes we don't even really know them ourselves. We don't really know what we long for. We don't really, at least in English, we talk about talents. And soon you have like a natural capability for some particular things. Some people have have a lot of talent for arts. They have like these particular latencies for us. Some people have great talent for science or math, right? But sometimes you don't really know. Some people did. Sometimes it's possible that everyone has these, but sometimes if they do not arise, then you might not realize that you have such a natural intelligence, and you might not know that in your entire life. So when someone looks with clairvoyant powers, they can see the capacities and faculties and latent talents, everything just kind of held that is not at all manifest, not even perhaps even something that the person themselves does not really know. So being able to know in a profound way the capacities, the intelligence of that being. So he would know this, and once he knew that, then he would teach Dharma that was appropriate for them and perform some sort of activity. In order to know that, you have to have clairvoyance. And among the clairvoyances, there are the worldly clairvoyances and the supermind or transcendent clairvoyances. Worldly clairvoyances are the not able to bring the students on the path of great enlightenment. Merely know the Fugyasi may have the power of actually knowing someone else's mind, but in order to bring the worldly Louis clairvoyances are not able to bring students onto the path of great enlightenment, because in order to be able to bring students onto the path of great enlightenment, it is something that's a little bit beyond your own level. And so in order to do that, you have to achieve the superman mundane or the transcendent clairvoyance of knowing the extinction of defilements. And if you have that clairvoyance, then you can bring sentient beings, students onto the path of great enlightenment. Bhikkhu Dorje saw this crucial point, and as it says in the root text, then he took all the virtue that he accumulated in his own life, he dedicated so that he could achieve such undefiled clairvoyance. Now, he's not saying that he has clairvoyance, but he says, I'd like to be able to benefit all sentient beings, and in order to do this, I need to gain this undefiled clairvoyance. In order to do that, I am dedicating all of my roots of virtue, all of the virtue that I've accumulated, I am dedicating it all for the sake of achieving that. Now, there are many causes for achieving undefiled clairvoyance, and what are the causes? The main one is the Mahayana teacher. It is to follow an infinite number of uncountable Mahayana teachers and to study the Dharma with them through listening, contemplating, meditation, and to do this in a limitless way. For example, there's this stories of Bodhisattvas who follow an incredible number of teachers. And so one of the examples is this Bodhisattva Norsang. We often speak about him, right, as an example for how we should follow many different teachers. So for the same way, in order to achieve the undefiled clairvoyance, we shouldn't just follow one or two Mahayana teachings. We need to engage in listening, contemplating, meditation, and not just one, a little bit, but an infinite amount from infinite sentient beings. And so for this reason, it says in the Noble Aspiration for Excellent Conduct, I'll purify completely oceans of realms and liberate completely oceans of beings. I will completely see the oceans of Dharma and totally realize the oceans of wisdom. I'll purify completely oceans of conduct, perfect completely oceans of aspirations, offer completely to the oceans of Buddhas, and act for oceans of eons undiscouraged. So for this reason, Sangye Paldrup, the author of the commentary on Bhikkhu Dorje's good deeds, said that though in the Bhikkhu Dorje in his own thought, he had the hope, and so for the people who praised him or who sought the Mahayana from him, depended upon or placed the hopes in him, Bhikkhu Dorje would, as I mentioned before, he cared for them in the way that's described before, as I spoke of in the Aspiration for Excellent Conduct. And due to this, then I think he must actually have had the undefiled clairvoyance. I have the feeling that he knows this, but if he does not have it, even if it doesn't have anything, he must have something that is like similar to something later with it. Now, this is some sort of like a bit of a presumption or like a feeling. I have a bit of a hope or a feeling. I think it's possible. And so he said, I have this like hope that it's like that. And some people might say that here, your guru is the Kamapa, right? The guru is your Kamapa. The Kamapa is a Buddha. And so since he's a Buddha, then you shouldn't have even a slightest doubt about whether he has a clairvoyance of knowing the extinction of defilements. For you to say, maybe he has it, or maybe he has something similar to it, to say it's possible. So the feeling that it isn't, to say that, just to speak like that is not okay. The way you're speaking is not okay. In the first of them, do you recognize that the karma is your root guru? You recognize the guru, then the karma was a Buddha, right? And since he's a Buddha, then the Buddha, of course, has the... There shouldn't be any doubt about whether the karmapa has undefiled clairvoyance. So the way you speak makes no sense at all. So if you look at it, is it possible that he has it? It's the way you simply just say that it's possible he has it, then it's true. So there were some people who said this to Sanjay Paldrup, but what Bhikshu Sanjay Paldrup said is, what you're saying is exactly true. It is true, but for an ordinary sentient being such as me, and for someone like me, the Sanjay Paldrup, my guru, Mikyo Dorje, often said that my guru is the essence of the karmapa is the essence of the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas. And likewise, many of the have recognized that many of the great masters in Nichiren have just look at the words of great masters and say, this is the karmapa. But instead, when I look for myself, and look at whether he's actually the Karmapa or the Guru or Buddha, I really don't know for myself. So I have no way of knowing whether or not he's a Buddha or whether he is an incarnation of the Karmapa. It's well known, it's commonly said that he's the Karmapa. And his previous incarnation, and many great students also recognize him as Kundalini. I think they probably aren't mistaken, I believe them. And so I have some conviction based on that. And I say that he's the Karmapa, but from my own perspective, I don't have the power to say that myself. And so for that reason, so when I say that he is the Karmapa, then I'm just following others' words. And so when I speak about it this way, I'm just following after the other master and saying what they are. Likewise, when I speak about the virtuous signs at his birth, and when there are many things about his deeds are comparable to the Buddhas and the Buddhist, this comes from like a liberation story by Aku Atra, or a liberation story by Gambo Kempo Shakya Sembo, the liberation story by Lama Punyi, and also those that are some liberation stories said to be by Mikyo Dorje himself. And so I think that these are reliable sources. And I've taken these as my basis. As I've written this commentary on the meaning of the autobiographical verses, Good Needs, other than that, I have not my perceived any of his clairvoyances or visions of Yidadunas or so forth. I have no of no. I don't know this because I don't have the capacity to know. I have not come to that level myself. In addition to that, Not only did I like that, Mikyo Dorje Hem also said, to show you all, it's really a kind of a scary thing that he said. This is what he said. Those of us who bear the title Karmapa are merely the blessings of the activity of the Karmapa himself. Aside from that, I have no thought that I am a rebirth of the Karmapa. So what he's saying is that all of us who have the title Karmapa are just blessings from the Karmapa of the just blessings of the activity of the previous Karmapas, but there's no, for my own point, I have no thought that I myself, that I'm actually rebirthed into the Karmapa. I don't think that at all, he's saying. Some say that when I was little, I recognized his attention. For example, when you're recognizing a chulku, you would, and assuming whether there's the reincarnation of the previous master, you take some statues and other articles and to show them to the boy as a way to recognize them. And they say that I recognize statues when I was and such when I was young, and that I took some in my hands, and some of them were because the ones that were the karma bus, some were ones that were not. And when they say, pick which one is the Karmapa statue, sometimes I'd get the Karmapa statue, sometimes I'd get ones that were not the Karmapa statue. Most of them were probably totally sequenced and don't take that one. When they say this one, they'd say to me, you know, beforehand, they'd say, tomorrow when they're going to, when they show them to you, this one, it's really pretty scary. That's a very this is a very scary thing to say. Many people shouldn't let people with doubts hear these. Also, some would say, sometimes people would say, which of these monks is your previous attendant? Or it's a, and they'd say this was one of your things as the younger things. Or they'd say, today I saw this or that deity, or these are evil people who will be reborn of the lower realms in the lifetimes. Or some people would say, they'd say, today I saw this deity. And tomorrow say that that you saw this or that deity. And if there are people whom you don't like, if there are people who you don't get along with, sometimes there are disagreements among the entourage, and should say these are only people are only going to predict that they're only going to be reborn in the lower realms in all their lifetimes. And for those who are close, say, for all the who are with me are emanations of the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas. So those who you get along with, and they say, this is the an emanation of Buddha, this is an emanation of Bodhisattva, this is an emanation of some Lama. And you say good things. They say that they're great beings, that they're excellent beings. And so I'd say, when I was young, he said, in particular, when asked questions about someone else's past and future lives, those nearby would write prose or verses about how they're connected to me or I have an emanation. So some would say, come and ask questions about past and future life. And the people around him, Mikyo Dorje, would say, so these are people who they'd check whether we have connection with them or not. And so they would write, and say that they'd write some things and write things for him, either in prose or in verse, and they'd have him give it to them. Like sometimes what they'd also do, sometimes what they do to some people, they'd say, first give like a kind of bad prediction, not such a bad prophecy. Then after you've given the bad prophecy, then the people would go, and the people around would look at it. And maybe offer some nicer things, some of the better things, and then gradually change the prophecy. First, you give a bad prophecy, right? it'd give a thing, and then you'd change the prophecy and make the prophecy get better and better. And so then they took my name to do this. And Mikyusimba Dorje said this. Mikyu Dorje gave that. And so they did all of this using my own name as the pretense. So it's all pretense, so one cannot rely on any of my previous liberation stories. So you basically shouldn't have any confidence and shouldn't rely on any of the liberation stories that I were said to have written when I was young. There are many different things. In some previous liberations, some old lamas, in order to prove that I was the Karmapa, made a comparison to life stories of earlier karmas. So old gurus at that time, there's a question of the problem of there being two Karmapas, and so they're, in order to prove that I was the Karmapa, they take examples from the previous Karmapas and then write various different stories about my life. Now there's a Namtarbai, or the life story by Mikyu Dorje Datsun Chunyipa, and here it speaks about the visions that he had while he was in the Bardo state and what he saw when he entered his mother's womb. And these topics, what the heck, what are these? He said, in this lifetime, this is not my life. But in order to be able to develop such life stories and so much be able to do this, I wrote this as like a prayer to be able to do this. It's not like I was making an account of something that that had already existed. Also, when recognizing the Shamar Kunji Yenlak, and when I recognized him, it was not through clairvoyant powers. That's not how it was. It's that the fourth Shamar himself had left a testament. And because of that, I just took that as the basis and recognized him. And it's not that I recognized him as the fourth Shamar, the fifth Shamar through my clairvoyance powers. But sometimes in Mikyu Dorje, it's hard to say whatever he thought or whatever he wanted. And people who speak like that are very few, are pretty rare, especially among lamas. And so Mikyu Dorje would speak like this. And when he spoke this, what most people thought is that Mikyu Dorje does say this, but actually he does have clairvoyance. He does remember a past life and such, but he pretends not to. It's like he's just pretending to do it. It's like he's just faking it. He's pretending not to do it, but he actually knows. So such words as those as we just went through are not literally. They're not intended literally. He's not speaking straightforwardly, even though he knows he's saying he doesn't. Even though he sees, he does not see. He does, even though he has clairvoyance, he pretends not to. Many people say this. Most people say this. But Sanjipaltrin himself thought that Mikyu Dorje was actually literally, he was speaking literally. It's exactly how it is, exactly true, is what he thought. He does not at all think that it is not true. You think it's exactly as it is that Mikyu Dorje had no clairvoyance. And the reason for that is that if Mikyu Dorje had transcendent qualities or supreme human qualities, and if he accepted that he had them, then there would be people who had misconceptions, then in order to prevent that, it would be possible that he'd say that he has it, but at this point, there's no reason to say like that. There are no people who have such misconceptions. And so, if you're going to say something that's like expedient meaning, or not literally after reason, but there's no reason. But what Sankhya Padmasambhava thinks is that for my own guru, Mikyo Dorje, many people think that the Karmapa is like this like emanation of the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas, and he has clairvoyances and so forth. But he thinks that but whether or not he has the qualities and clairvoyances, the Karmapa, Sanjayapada, it doesn't, if he not having clairvoyances and miraculous powers does not mean that he's not the Karmapa. Having them does not mean that he is the Karmapa either. The reason for this is that it's seen that the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas have made many emanations. They make many different emanations, and they take many different births, and among them, for like with the Buddha, he has many qualities, such as remembering past lives and telepathy and so forth. But sometimes, but he also has emanated forms where they don't have the qualities of a Buddha, the telepathy or the quality of remembering past lives. For example, when the Buddha emanated himself as dogs and pigs, when we look at them, we don't see them as having the qualities of remembering past lives and so forth. They're just regular pigs and dogs as far as we see. And if you look at them, it doesn't seem like a dog or pig that's any different than any other one. It's not like a pig or dog that's, you know, like radiating light or like golden colored sort of dog or pig. That's not how we see them. But even though we do not see that, but that does not, does that mean that they're not not an emanation of the Buddha? We can't say that either. For example, it's like there's a story of seeing Maitreya, the Bodhisattva Maitreya, as a dog's corpse. So when we talk about Maitreya's, there's the story of a Sangha seeing Maitreya as a dog. So in any ways, we don't need to speak about that. But whether or not Mikyo Dorje remembered past lives or displayed miracles, whether he did or not, in any case, but in many people's appearance, it's not just like some sort of like, you know, experience that they had, but actually had, the ordinary people had said like shared perceptions of his appearances. This did occur. I don't know whether people, he has miraculous powers or not, but the way people see it, and this is not just the from the experience of realized meditators. It's like the shared perceptions of ordinary individuals that he performed miracles. For example, at that time, the Chinese emperor was the, he was in the Ming Dynasty, and it's like, it was probably the last Ming emperor. At that time, the emperor was the Chinese emperor had invited the Mikyo Dorje, and Mikyo Dorje was unable to go, and he sent a lama, Dongsa Goshri, a lama with the title of Goshri, to he had the title of Goshri. And so at that time, the emperor said, "You are lying when you're saying that you're the envoy of the Karmapa." And so he's about to punish him. And at that time, then Mikyo Dorje came wearing his black crown in the sky. And all the emperor and most of the emperors inside the Golden Hall saw his illness in the Great Kingdom. This isn't a Tibetan story. It's like most of the emperor and most of his minister saw this. So they're probably in the palace in Beijing. Most of the emperor and most of the ministers actually saw the Karmapa then. And at that time, the emperor and most of the ministers saw this. So these are like two cranes, two long life birds, the cranes, were also circling the top of the palace, the spire of the palace, which is a very auspicious symbol. Likewise, when the emperor was inviting Mikidorji, he sent the Taijin and others, so including Nyurumba and others, and as well as a large army, probably over 10,000 people probably arrived. They all went together to escort the Karmapa. And the day before they were going to arrive at the great encampment, on that morning, on their way, there was a snow mountain, and above the snow mountain, they saw within the midst of rainbows and clouds, they saw Karmapa wearing the black hat with the golden blaze. And at that time, the emperor's envoy, as well as the soldiers, all saw this directly. And another time, they were going to Nyarong. So Mikidorje was going to Nyarong, and in Nyarong, there's a river called the Nyakchu. It's a river called the Nyakchu. And if they wanted to cross the river, they need a ferry to go across. It's a big river, so there's no way to go. So you needed a ferry to go there. But they didn't have but they couldn't agree on a price for the ferryman, how much they should pay. There's a lot of people in the great encampment, so they were in a dispute over how much they should pay for the ferries. And so the ferryman wouldn't take them. And the entire encampment was on the had arrived at the end, it was blocked at the river. And in that evening, the Nyakchu center immediately froze over. So the whole river became covered with ice. And it's a very thick ice. And even if it's frozen, then you can walk across it. And the people and horses can cross. And so that night, it suddenly froze. And the next morning, the entire encampment didn't need to take the ferries, and they could just go straight right across. They could cross on the ice, and they could get to the other shore. And once they'd got through the other side, then immediately the ice broke up. It immediately broke up. And at that time, many people from Nyakrong saw what they perceived as that Karmapa Mikidorje was flying in the sky above the water. So this is the perception that many of them had. Likewise, when Mikidorje is going to Kham or Kongpo or other regions, when you go to many places, he would leave handprints or footprints in Ra. There are many of these hand and footprints. Like also there's a time when you have the barley from his hands. Like for example, those days travel was not easy when there's a new when people were building a new mani building or a temple or a statue and so forth, they'd ask the Karmapa to consecrate it. And he said, now he wouldn't be able to go because he can't immediately go over there. But from long way, they'd say, please give the consecration from far away. So at that time, when giving the consecration, one time, he would give the consecrations like there's an area from Kongpo to Soksang, there's a time that he was going to do that. And so at this time, we're going to they asked him to give the dissident that day, and he would go to give the consecration. And he'd have had barley, right? And he'd toss the rain, and the rain appeared all from second to second, and all became seeds. In that summer, the seeds, the barley seeds he'd used for the consecration, all became sprouted in the summer. There are times when he's consecrating a statue or a painting, then the barley the barley used for the consecration would not fall down to the ground. It stayed right in front of the painting and would stay there for many days. And so there are many such incredible, inconceivable instances. And so even his horses and mules and zoos and dogs were able to leave hoof prints. And when they died, their bones would emanate piles of relics, and they would radiate light and so forth. There are many such amazing signs. But Sandipada does say here, and he's actually someone who spoke very straightforward. What he says is that there are those that he actually left, but there's some that, but some of his hand and footprints were made by other people. So like there's some that people carved into this, carved into rock. So he's asking them, if you were going to, whether Mikyo Dorje has qualities or not, please do not make, if you make any false, fake things in order for people to gather accumulation, then if you, it's not good for you to accumulate such misdeeds. So whether they're true or not, of course there are many people who do things. So people who want to gain some benefit and to do many fake things, right? And so this is a question of whether he has the clairvoyance of producing miracles. Now the clairvoyance of telepathy, Sajipatada says that I don't know whether or not Mikyo Dorje has the telepathy of knowing other minds, because I don't have that. I don't have that. I'm not the level where I can realize it, so I can't actually say. But many people who have faith, when they came into his presence, most of them would say, he knows without impediment that I had such a sort of thought or everything that I've done in secret. Mikyo Dorje just knows him exactly. He knows this. Sanjay Pendrit said, many people have said this to me. Many people have told me about this frequently. And among those people who say that, some of them, many people want to boast to others that Mikyo Dorje is caring for them, and so that showing that they're a great person, but we don't know. But some of them, it's probably true. There are quite a few that were true. In general, when Mikyo Dorje was speaking, when it was speaking as things actually are and were being pointed, is not necessarily only that Mikyo Dorje had clairvoyance, because Mikyo Dorje was incredibly great in intelligence. He's really sharp mind, and because of this, when he looked at the way people did things, looked at their expressions, he could basically know mostly how that person is. And so for that reason, Mikyo Dorje would kind of say jokingly, some people, I do know a little bit about how people think and what they're saying, but that's no telepathy. That's not clairvoyance. That's because I knew it from observation. You can observe it, you know. You look at the person's tongue, you can know. So to protect your, so guard your tongue, or I'll be looking at it. If you look at a person's eyes and tongues, then you immediately know how they're thinking. So you guard your tongue, otherwise I'll be afraid. Could say this in jest. And so for this reason, Mikyo Dorje, when they came to Mikyo Dorje, they said, you should not dare to think even a bad thought when you come to Mikyo Dorje's presence. So there are many people had this feeling. In any case, Mikyo Dorje himself, to speak up, he was really, to say it clear, he was really clever. He was really intelligent. So no one else could fool him. No one could lie to him and get away with a lie. And he knows directly seeing what's being done in secret. If you say something false, you say something to false to him, but he immediately knows. You don't need to examine whether it is. He doesn't need to examine because he knows already. For example, when you go to see Mikyo Dorje, you think, probably Mikyo Dorje understand, knows this event, so I'm not going to say anything about it. And you'd go to Mikyo Dorje, and he would show the expression as if he knows, but he wouldn't say anything much about that at all. He would seem to clearly know, but he wouldn't say much about it. Sometimes, you'd think of it today, I need to tell him clearly about the event. And then you go to see this, and before you could ask him, they'd say this, and say, "Oh, this is what happened. This has happened." Before you could tell him, he told you. Sometimes when you go see Mikyo Dorje, if you have a good or a bad thought, kind of like there's a little bit of variation of that. He immediately. You could tell from the way he looked and the way he and in the smile, you could see immediately a distinction. When he had a good or a bad thought, it changed the way he thought. It's like he's scanning you, just kind of thinking about, what's he thinking? And so the way he'd be smiling, the way he'd look at you is different. Sometimes there's some people that are really, extreme afflictions. So you could tell it immediately knew how strong your afflictions were, how not strong your faith. In particular, there are people who have strong afflictions, and like a contamination for it. It's like sometimes we feel like if you go to the presence of a murder, we talk about this as like being a contamination, right? It's kind of like the energy, right? In Tibetan, we call it drip. It's like an energy. But most of us don't really know it. But for those who have really thin karmic obscurations, they immediately know. They can feel it immediately. Some people immediately kind of have this feeling, someone who is, when they're brought in the presence of someone who has murdered someone or killed someone. And this is feel of disease or... So I feel of discomfort with them. Some people just don't understand. No, you can spend your entire life, wherever you go, if you go to Buddha or Bodhisattva, it's all the same. You have no particular feeling about any of them, but for Mikyo Dorje, it was like that because he's very sensitive. There are people that are really strong afflictions, he'd immediately feel discomfort or a little bit unhealthy. And what Mikyo Dorje said in one of his songs, this illness determined the elements of my body. It's nothing but a fault in my student's Dharma practice. So when he had ill health, or when he had sickness is because the students were not really acting the way, in a dharmic way, and it's because of that that he had this bit of ill health. And it's the opposite of that. When there are people with few afflictions, and a great faith and devotion would come to Mikidorje. If he wasn't not so healthy, then he'd become start showing good health. He'd be able to feel better. He'd seem pleased, and he would speak. And so Sangye Pelder, what he says is that, in his opinion, if you want the guru to always be healthy and not to get sick, then the most thing is that for the students themselves must make sure that their mind stream, they're not affected by the faults of wrong thoughts and so forth. And likewise, you also must have devotion that is free of boasting and sectarianism. And you have to supplicate the guru and invoke their blessings and so forth. Likewise, Mikidorje, sometimes they would go to places, like the old days, not like it is today when there's phones, internet, anything like that we have today, right? And Tibet is a huge place. They go to some remote place, you don't know. If you haven't, if you don't know the artist, you have no idea what's going on in any place. You don't immediately know what's going on, if it's thieving or banditry or anything like that. But Mikidorje, what always knew about this better than anyone else. Mikidorje always knew more about it than the people who, within his friends and the people around him. For example, if some people, if you look at it, they seem to be well-behaved and good, but actually their intentions are bad. But they could never deceive Mikidorje. Sometimes one's intentions are good, but on the outside it looks like it's like you're acting out of the afflictions, like that it looks like you're acting behaving badly. And sometimes, but Mikidorje would actually never compassionately never give up on them. But also obstinate fools and braggarts, and you'd say to Dorothy, your situation is like this, really clearly and directly. Mikidorje would show them directly. So there, so like to give an example, is there was a Lo Tokten, and then everyone said he's a great, you know, Mahasiddhas. Everyone said they're the greatest. Lo Tokten, they said. He became well known. And one time, Mikidorje called him and he said, Mikidorje said, and he said, you are not a Mahasiddha. You have not achieved siddhi. You have been blessed by ghosts and demons. He said this directly to him. So Lo Tokten, it was the one that everyone said was the Mahasiddha, but Mikidorje was not at all hesitant about saying, you are not a Mahasiddha, you've been blessed by demons, you are not a Mahasiddha. But when he says things like this, if it wasn't the right time to say it, he wouldn't say things at all, anything at all. When that was the right time, he'd say it without hesitation. But he didn't like it. It's not that he was saying such things all the time. So in brief, so when we look at Mikidorje's deeds and examples, it's not like, it seems as if there's nothing that he did not know about other, the way other people thought about their intentions and the way they behaved. But Mikidorje had absolutely no wish for material things or fame. So in a generated age, there are many people who say we have clairvoyances and they have miraculous powers. And so he never acted as such as those people do. And so for normally just spend his time there as if he had no clairvoyances. Because if because of the danger that if you say something directly from clairvoyance or something, then there's a danger that in front of many people, they might be very embarrassed. And for some, though, that if you tell them that, it would just get them angry and it wouldn't help them in any way. There's no purpose to saying it. And if you show if you show the appearance of having clairvoyance, then people are going to have many projections and exaggerations about that. So you just often plan to be an ordinary sentient with no clairvoyances at all. So that is what he always said, that he had no clairvoyant powers at all. For example, in later times, and in fact, a lot of people came to ask Rinpoche Dorje for divinations. Like these days, a lot of people say this. And Rinpoche Dorje would say, I don't do divinations. I don't know how to do them. And he wouldn't do divinations. It says, it said in the 25,000 line Prajnaparamita, as it says, you know, if an irreversible Buddha says you're going to make a prediction, you're going to have a son or a daughter, you live long or so forth. This is, don't make predictions, don't make prophecies. As it says in the Prajnaparamita, I have a, so if someone comes to me, I have my wife is pregnant, is it a boy or is it a girl? You wouldn't make a prediction. So as this is said, so in the beginning, he probably did make a few such predictions, but later he did not. Now, sometimes there are people with a whole lot of faith, like when their parents had passed away. My parents have passed away, and so where have they born? So please ask them to stand. Like their eyes were filled with tears as they asked, and they're really insistent as they asked. There were some people who came. And when that happened, then he really out of compassion, in order to, he was afraid to refuse them, and out of compassion for them, he said not that it would be difficult. So what he would do is, he'd take the six, he'd like little, like scrolls, and he'd take, to write the names of each of the six realms, he'd put each of them, roll them up and put them in balls of dough. And then whichever one, then they'd pick the one, and whichever one they picked, he did never pretend that he had clairvoyances. So that's one example. Like when we take the mode definitions. For one example, the most can be are good because there's a way of doing most. It's not clairvoyance. We do the mo divinations. It's a way to do it. If you know how to do mo, you don't need to have clairvoyance because you can do the divinations through mo. So many great beings carry their do divinations, and the reason for that is that if they pretended that they had clairvoyance and sat there and did not do any divinations, then you're sort of just showing that you have clairvoyance. And when you show that, then people might have all sorts of ideas about that. And in a degenerate time, there'd be many who pretend to have the clairvoyance as mirrored kind of. So in order to prevent that, even if you have clairvoyance, you should not show this, and instead do divinations like Mo and so forth, and astrology. And so it's important to do this in the way people see things. So now we'll take a 20-minute break. I've already spoken about his telepathy, as telepathic powers. Now, to speak about his the clairvoyance of remembering past lives, in the accounts of the life stories of previous karmapas speak of how most Indian and Tibetan scholars and siddhas were the same mind stream as the karmapa or previous lifetimes of the previous incarnations of the karmapa. And when Mikyo Dorje spoke about these, as they're talked, said in the life stories of previous karmapas, most people who listened to him must know that this was his previous birth. They think that it is a they recognized as Mikyo Dorje speaking about his own personal rebirth. For example, when an individual dies, and then thinking about what realm they're reborn in, and whether they're in the Bardo, when they're staying in the Bardo, Mikyo Dorje said that I had a dream about this deceased individual. I had this dream that this birth that they had been reborn somewhere. That's all he would say about it. Otherwise, he wouldn't say anything about it. But his attendants and would really exaggerate this and say, I said, oh, Yawan Karmapa. He said that he saw the deceased being in the Bardo. I saw what happened to them in the Bardo state. And they see that this such a being was reborn in this place. And so they made a lot of such exaggeration projections and announced it to other people. But when you think about, in terms of the clairvoyance of extinguishing the defilements, whether Mikyo Dorje himself actually had is something that Mikyo Dorje has it or not, Sanjay Paldrup could not tell, but he did have the prajna, the discreet obscuration from antidote, and this did depend upon anyone else's words. He knew the critical point about what needed to be eliminated and what was an antidote. And he was also able to understand the meaning of the great texts, the words of the Buddha and the great commentaries. He was able to understand this directly just by reading them. In particular, he could tell what experience the students had had of shamatha and insight just by looking at them. And so he always knew, he never missed the time to give it exactly the right time instructions on eliminating obstacles or enhancing their practice, in particular for those through his practice of the secret mantra practice of the pranas, nadis, and bindus. He was giving an instruction in the secret mantra or an empowerment. He could see whether it would be beneficial to that other being. And he could clearly know. So basically, he's able to clearly examine and see. He could tell us if someone's experience is good or bad, or if when they're practicing, what sort of level of practice they would have. Even if he could not see, he could say that this is going to happen to this person, he'll have those things, he'd give these predictions, and he is able to give them clearly and without clearly and without impediment. So that's basically that. So maybe that's enough for today, I think. I've already spoken quite a bit. And you off go and have your supper. So the remainder, I'll speak about tomorrow. And the day after tomorrow, what I will speak about is the remainder of the praise he searched thoroughly, as well as the remainder from the remainder on the autobiographical versus good deeds, and I'll also speak a little bit about the black pills as well. Also, there are over 30 volumes of Mikyo Dorje's works, and among them, there are some that are very important and necessary for us who are studying the great texts, the commentary on Abhidharma, the commentary on the Vinaya Sutras, the commentary on Prajnaparamita, and the commentary on the Entering the Middle Way. And so among the Karma Kams and commentaries on the five great texts, the commentary on epistemology, it was by Seventh Karmapa Mikyo Dorje, but the one who wrote all the others completely was Mikyo Dorje. So this is one of his important deeds. And so Mikyo Dorje had a very great influence on all five of these. Now, because of the time, I thought I should give an introduction to each of these, but I haven't had time to speak about them. So I thought that the day after tomorrow I'd give a brief introduction to the rest for the yogis, the commentary on the ornament of clear realization. There's not time to speak out of others. In the future, if there is time, then perhaps I hope I can be able to say a little bit. I can do something to explain that. Now, in the future, if we have a situation, an opportunity like now, and if my health is good, then I would like to be able to. The commentaries on the four great texts, as Rangdur Dorje's and profound inner meaning, and so forth. I have the thought that I should be able to teach it. And I don't know whether I'm going to teach them all from the beginning to end, but at least to teach about it a few critical points and some my opinions about them. So my thoughts about some of them. And I think of this as like a service to the teachings or a service to Mikyo Dorje's deeds and activity. In any case, we are completing our spring teachings this year. We're completing the autobiographical verses of Mikyo Dorje. So next year, during the spring teaching, instead of speaking about Mikyo Dorje's autobiographical verses, we should think about what to say. If you have any opinions, it's important for you to all express your opinions. There are things that I don't think about. Sometimes my own brain doesn't spin properly. So among all of us are teachers and students, if you have any ideas, it's good for you to express it to me directly. All of you from the nuns' shedras, and also the people from the monks' shedras, if you all could share your opinions, that would be good. And my opinion is that there's the 50 verses of the gurus. In the past, in the Kamsang, there were some Vajrayana Shudras where we studied mantra, tantras. And in these, the first text that they taught was the 50 verses of the Guru. And after that, they would speak about the presentation on the downfalls, according to the presentation by Karmapa Rangjung Dorje. And then they would also speak about the four classes of tantras, and then they'd speak about the profound inner meaning, the Hevajra Tantra and the sublime continuing. In particular, it's the profound inner meaning and the Hevajra Tantra that are particular presentation. So originally the idea was that during the spring, I thought I'd teach it during the summer teaching, but in the summer teaching, there is a danger that it's going to take still another year or two. It's a situation, it's a danger that it'll take another year or two. So I thought that perhaps during the spring teaching, I'd teach the 50 verses of the Guru and the ocean of Samaya. And so I had been thinking about this, but I haven't yet definitely decided about this. And so it's important for all of you teachers and students to share your opinions and to speak about it freely. Then you can share your opinion, and whether I can finish it or not, I can see if I can do it. But if you don't even share your opinion, then I can't do anything about it, because sometimes I don't know what to do, and I don't know what is most, we've got to think about what's best and what is most beneficial. From one perspective, our concentrations in our in general, our tradition of teaching the Karma Kamsang has was lost for a while, and so we all need to work together to recover and restore them. Okay, so that's how. A peaceful Kaya with three faces and eight arms, appearing from the empty nature of Dharmata, as a beautiful illusory goddess. O best of gods, please protect us. May the deities of deathless life, who triumph over the Lord of Death and dispel the obstacles to life, extend the glorious Guru's life. Through the always peaceful Dharmakaya, the constant flow of Sambhogakaya, and various emanated marvels, may the Guru's body, firm and stable, with burgeoning life force live long within the field of vision of us disciples as a glorious symbol of constancy, and ripen the good field of disciples with the rain of Dharma that matures the three families, Gurus, three jewels, Yidam deities, and protectors of the Vajra Dharma who have so smile. Do not neglect this, even a moment, fulfill our prayers. O peaceful Kaya with three faces and eight arms, appearing from the empty nature of Dharmata, as a beautiful illusory goddess, O best of guides, please protect us. May the deities of deathless life, who triumph over the Lord of Death and dispel the obstacles to life, extend the glorious Guru's life. Through the always peaceful Dharmakaya, a constant flow of Sambhogakaya, and the various emanated marvels, may the Guru's body, firm and stable, with burgeoning life force live long within the field of vision of us disciples, as a glorious symbol of constancy, and ripen the good field of disciples with the rain of Dharma that matures the three families, Gurus, three jewels, Yidam deities, and protectors of Vajra Dharma who have Samaya. Do not neglect this, even a moment, fulfill our prayers. O peaceful Kaya with three faces and eight arms, appearing from the empty nature of Dharmata, as a beautiful illusory goddess, O best of guides, please protect us. May the deities of deathless life, who triumph over the Lord of Death and dispel the obstacles to life, extend the glorious Guru's life. To the always peaceful Dharmakaya, the constant flow of Sambhogakaya, and various emanated marvels, May the Guru's body firm and stable, with a burgeoning life force live long within the field of vision of us disciples, as a glorious symbol of constancy and ripen the good field of disciples with the rain of Dharma that matures the three families. Gurus, three jewels, freedom deities, and protectors of Vajradharma who have some Messiah, do not neglect us for even a moment, fulfill our prayers.